Hey, welcome back to the channel, everybody. This is Kevin. And in this week's video, we're going to be considering a very fundamental networking concept, a MAC address, a media access control address. In this video, you're going to learn the structure of a MAC address, and you're going to learn its purpose in life in the network. And if you enjoy this video, do me a favor, click the like button down below, and always subscribe so you don't miss any of our future content. Now enjoy this short training on MAC addresses. Every client connected to an Ethernet network has a unique identifier called a Media Access Control Address, or a MAC address for short. And in this video, we're going to take a look at the structure of a MAC address and its purpose in life in the network. The first thing I want you to know about a MAC address, and you might want to put this in your notes, is that it is 48 bits in length. That is, as opposed to an IP version 4 address, which has 32 bits, or an IP version 6 address that has 128 bits. And a MAC address is going to be written using hexadecimal notation. So instead of, as in decimal, having the numbers of just 0 through 9 to work with, we have 0 through F. In other words, we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But instead of saying 10, we say A. Instead of saying 11, we say B. And it counts all the way up to A, B, C, D, E, F, where F equals a 15. So if we think about it, a hexadecimal address has 16 possible values in the range of 0 through F. How many binary bits does it take to represent 16 different values? The answer is 4. 2 raised to the power of 4 gives us 16 different values. So if we have a 48-bit address, and each hexadecimal digit represents 4 bits, how many hexadecimal digits do you think we're going to have? Yeah, it's 48 divided by 4. We're going to have 12 hexadecimal digits. And I want you to know that these 48 bits, or these 12 hexadecimal digits, they're divided into 2 distinct parts. You see, when a manufacturer is creating networking gear, if they have an Ethernet interface in that gear, then they're going to be assigned what is called a vendor code, or some people call that an OUI, an organizationally unique identifier. And that's going to be the first half of the MAC address. For example, when the manufacturer of this network interface card was building it, they were assigned a vendor code, an OUI, and their first 24 bits had to be the bits that they were assigned. But then, once they begin their MAC address with their vendor code, they could really follow it up with just about any digits they wanted. This is called a NIC-specific portion of the address. Now, NIC, that could stand for Network Interface Card, or some people prefer Network Interface Controller, but this makes up the structure of a MAC address. 48 bits total. We begin with the first 24 bits as the vendor code, or the OUI, and then we follow it up with the NIC-specific address. And as an example, I took a look at the MAC address on my Mac computer, and here it is. Here's the vendor code, and the vendor code begins like this, and you can go out on the web and you can look up what vendor codes are associated with which vendors. And if you look this one up, you're going to see that that's associated with Apple. And then Apple assigned these 6 hexadecimal digits, or 24 bits, as the NIC-specific bits. And that makes up the MAC address on my Mac. The next question is, why do we need a MAC address? Why is this so important? Well, let me give you a couple of big uses for MAC addresses. For example, let's say that you're trying to get off of your local network out to the internet. You want to go to a web server somewhere. Well, you don't know the MAC address of that web server. You'll never know the MAC address of that web server. It doesn't matter. But when you're communicating to your default gateway, in other words, the router that's going to get you on your way to that web server out on the internet, you've got to know not just the IP address of that default gateway, you've got to know its MAC address. And with IP version 4, when a client first boots up, it's configured with the IP address of the default gateway. Maybe we statically configured it, maybe it learned it via DHCP, but somehow it knows the IP address of the default gateway. But it has no clue what the MAC address is, and we have to have the MAC address of the default gateway, because when we're sending a layer 2 frame to that gateway, we need to know what is the source and the destination MAC address on this network segment. Our MAC address, that's going to be the source. And the default gateway, that's going to be the destination. So what does the client do? It sends out an ARP broadcast, an address resolution protocol broadcast, asking, hey, does anybody know the MAC address corresponding to this IP address? Let's say it's 10.1.1.1. The router sees that and it says, yeah, that's me. I'm 10.1.1.1 and here is my MAC address. Now, the PC knows the MAC address and the IP address of the default gateway, and it can send its frame there, and then that default gateway will send it on its way. Another use for a MAC address is with Ethernet switching. If we have a bunch of clients plugged into an Ethernet switch, as traffic comes into those various switch ports, the switch is going to begin to build a MAC address table. It's going to learn what MAC addresses live off of which ports. Then, when a frame comes in destined for a specific MAC address, that Ethernet switch is going to check its MAC address table, and it's going to say, oh, let's see, here is this MAC address that you're going to. It lives off of port gig 1, as an example. And that switch will send the traffic just out the appropriate port. It doesn't have to flood it out everywhere. And those are a couple of purposes for MAC addresses as well as the structure.